Hello and welcome. I'm Raghunath and my wife Namisha and I co-founded Ārāmse. We create content around coffee on Instagram and YouTube. We design coffee-related products and we also provide a coffee subscription service. So clearly we're very coffee obsessed. And if you'd like to know a little bit more about us, check the links in the description below. I'd like to start by saying how truly honored and excited we are to have been given this platform to talk about something that we're so passionate about. As the title suggests, we're going to be talking about how flavor can play a pivotal role in decolonizing coffee. The goal here is to create an environment that includes producing countries and shaping the next wave of coffee. We've gone ahead and divided this video into three distinct parts. Part 1, localizing the SEA flavor wheel. Part 2, rethinking traditional brewing methods to be relevant in today's world of specialty coffee. And number 3, the importance of preserving original names and why cultural appropriation needs to be recognized and avoided. We really hope this video helps start an open dialogue and shed light on a topical problem through a different lens. So let's dive right in. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the SEA flavor wheel, this is it. And the 2016 update is arguably the largest and most collaborative piece of research on coffee flavor ever completed. The foundation of this work, the World Coffee Research Sensory Lexicon, is a product of dozens of professional sensory panelists, scientists, coffee buyers, and roasting companies collaborating via SEA and the WCR. For those of you interested in reading more about this, there's a link in the description below. Now, this tool has somehow made its way out of the labs and professional circles and into the homes of coffee enthusiasts world over, including producing countries like India. So this trend is what sparked the idea of localizing the flavor wheel to make it more inclusive. One way in which this can be achieved is by replacing items that are harder to find or more expensive with ones that are local and more easily available. So let's look at some India-specific examples. The amla or Indian gooseberry is a very interesting fruit that hits you with a sharp, rip your head off acidity, much like biting a slice of lime. This then gives way to a series of bitters, and once your palate has had a chance to recover from the shock, you're left with a rather confounding, sweet and lingering aftertaste. The jamun or Indian blackberry is another fruit that offers a wild gustatory and olfactory experience. The ripe fruit starts with a round, berry-like tartness that is soon accompanied by a syrupy, juicy, grape-like sweetness. But what follows shortly after is what will truly surprise you. An extreme astringency will leave your mouth drier than the Atacama, making you yearn for that next bite, while also enjoying the strange sensation of dragging your bone-dry tongue over the roof of your mouth. Now bear with me, there is a point to these verbose descriptions. These foods, like many others, offer a cornucopia of sensory stimuli that can relate to coffee on various fronts, and if done scientifically, can be used to replace items on the wheel that are hard to find in situ. Similarly, jackfruit, jaggery, or kokum, the Indian mangosteen, are some other alternatives that come to mind. This ease of access will encourage consumers and even producers to deepen their understanding of flavor in coffee. For example, a producer who can clearly articulate what a buyer can expect in terms of flavor puts him or her in a much more commanding position. Now, the SEA flavor wheel and sensory lexicon are scientific tools that are designed to be objective, but the real-world implementation isn't as straightforward as they were largely developed in US and Europe. This could lead to some implicit biases as to which flavors are desirable and which aren't. One example that stands out is the tasting note earthy. In spite of it being quite sought after in the subcontinent, seeing it nestled between moldy and phenolic makes one almost embarrassed to admit that they enjoy it. Another particularly fascinating non-coffee example would be asafoetida, or hing in Hindi. This is a highly sought-after spice in different regional cuisines in India and is meant to add oomph to a dish. However, this same spice, due to its aroma, which most Indians don't find offensive by the way, is nicknamed stinking resin or devil's dung in English. We see this a lot in the food industry where flavors and spices that are not from the West are often described as pungent, exotic, intense, and harsh, until the cuisine has been appropriated by a largely white audience. So the question we'd like to ask is, can we rethink the position of certain flavors and also include new ones based on location? For example, certain very fermented notes could be delightful to some, but repulsive to others. Think durian. Now, of course, these localized wheels would be developed through proper scientific research and flavor analysis. We are also happy to report that this presentation is part of a larger project that Namisha is working on with authorized SEA trainer Erica Koss. It is for her professional level certification in the SEA Sustainability Coffee Program. So let's talk about the South Indian filter. Now, little is documented about the history of how this nifty little brewer came to be. This actually speaks to the importance of culture being preserved. Coffee drinking, prepared with hot milk and honey or jaggery, became widespread among South Indians somewhere in the 19th century and spread further with the establishment of the India Coffee House in the 20th century. The brewer to prepare coffee in this way transitioned from earthen to brass and eventually to steel, the latter two being synonymous with the drink Digri Kapi, which is still immensely popular amongst Indians. So to show you how we use this brewer, we've put together a little something special. Cue the B-roll. This brewer is delightfully simple, with its three-part dual-chamber, single-material design that is super functional and will last you several lifetimes. In fact, this brass one here has been handed down 4 generations and is probably over 100 years old. This is the top chamber that has tiny holes at the base that act as a filter. The bottom chamber is where the coffee drips into. Lastly, the lid helps maintain a higher brew temperature by keeping the heat in. Both espresso and V60 are percolation brewing methods where water seeps through a bed of coffee. With espresso, you have very fine grinds and it's brewed under pressure, so a shot takes around 20 to 30 seconds typically. Whereas with a V60, you're going to be brewing a little slower with a medium grind size and it takes typically 2.5 to around 4, 4.5 minutes. The grind size required to brew with the South Indian filter can range from espresso fine all the way down to Turkish. And it's this combo of ultra fine grinds and slow percolation that give this brewer its unique flavor profile. With brew times that last between 7 and 15 minutes, the gradual heat loss results in a mellow acidity and a sweet, rich, heavy coffee concentrate that can be used much like espresso to make milk-based drinks. While this brewer has been historically used with dark roasted, chicory blended commodity coffee to prepare a milky drink with lots of sugar, our experiments have shown that it's more than capable of brewing a delicious cup of specialty coffee while maintaining its unique flavor profile. So we'd like to urge you to experiment and push these brewers because you'll be surprised at how well newer techniques like swirls, slow pours using a gooseneck kettle, and WDT actually work. So to round out this segment, we'll just say that one shouldn't have to seek out a Vietnamese cafe to order a pheen, or an Indian coffee house to get a kapi. What we propose is to not view these brewers as relics relegated to museums, but give them a chance to show off their chops in today's world of coffee. The importance of a name and preservation of it are often overlooked. Today, we'll look at how this affects the F&B industry that coffee is a part of. In order to dive into this subject, we need to first discuss cultural appropriation. Cultural appropriation is the adoption of an element or elements from one culture by members of another culture. Now, this becomes controversial when a dominant culture appropriates from disadvantaged minority cultures and is in fact a form of colonialism. To drive this point home swiftly and efficiently, let's look at one great example, the turmeric latte. How many of you know that this drink originated in India, called Haldi Ka Doodh in Hindi, Pasupu Palu in Telugu, and so on in different regional languages? It's an age-old Ayurvedic remedy for general health and immunity. This somehow needed to go through a bastardization and appropriation process to be adopted into mainstream and now bears absolutely no traces to its roots. That distinct flavor of turmeric with hot milk and spices like pepper, licorice, and cardamom, when referred to by its original name, helps trigger a direct association to its origin and also ensues a sense of pride and ownership. We make a lot of effort to pronounce croissant, cappuccino, and macchiato correctly, so it would be nice to hear haldi doodh instead of turmeric latte. Similarly, it would be great to walk into a Proof Rock or an Ozone and order a filter copy. And for those who enjoy that flavor profile, the name creates a direct link back to the origin country. Ultimately, coffee is a beverage, and its flavor is at the heart of what makes it so popular around the world. These are just a few ways that we think coffee-producing countries can be made to feel more included in the world of specialty coffee. By opening people's minds to different flavors, international consumers have a wider variety of choices available to them. Also, local roasters get international exposure. Lastly, and arguably most importantly, as producers feel more connected to the final product, that is roasted coffee and not just green beans, they get to participate in the dialogue around specialty coffee and its unique offerings. This paves the way for greater economic sustainability as they are able to undertake endeavors such as roasting on site, roasting at origin, or even producing and branding coffee from farm to cup. So all we ask is you keep an open mind. I'd like to end this video with a few thank yous. Firstly, a huge thank you to James for always pushing the boundaries of creativity with his content and giving fellow creators like us such a huge platform to present on. Next, I'd like to thank my sister-in-law, Niharika, for her invaluable support in shooting this entire video in less than ideal conditions. I'd like to thank my wife, Namisha, the anchor behind the scenes without who none of this would have been possible. And lastly, thank you so much for watching and hope you have a great day.